Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to the Q1 FY22 earnings conference call of NCC Limited, hosted by Centrum Broking Limited. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Ashish Shah from Centrum Broking. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Yeah, thanks, Rutuja. On behalf of Centrum Broking, I welcome everyone to the Q1 FY22 earnings conference call of NCC Limited. Today we have from the management Mr. Y.D. Murthy, Executive Vice President Finance, Mr. K.K. Rao, Executive Vice President Finance and Accounts, and Mr. K. Durga Prasad, Joint General Manager Finance. We will begin with opening remarks from the management, after which we'll have the Q&A session. So over to you, sir. Over to you, Mr. Murthy.
Thank you, Ashish. Good afternoon to all the participants. I am Y.D. Murthy, Executive Vice President from the company, and we'll take you through the first quarter results of the company. Initially, I will make a few comments, and then we will discuss the first quarter results. First of all, as you know, the economy is in an uptick, and things are definitely improving for the economy, and definitely they are improving for the construction industry also. And if you make a comparison of Q1 FY21 and Q2 FY22, both the quarters there was a pandemic, and the economy was badly impacted. In fact, in April 2020, there was a general complete lockdown. The supply chain was disrupted because the national highways were closed. So we really suffered. And therefore, in Q1 FY21, the economy shrunk by about 23.9%. And the biggest contributor to that shrinkage was the construction industry, which reported about 50% shrinkage in the Q1 FY21. That is very abnormal. We also reported about 40-42% decline in turnover in the first quarter of last year. Whereas in the current year, that problem is not there. The supply chain is not broken. The highways are ready, and the raw material supply is there. And also, in Q1 FY21, the clients have told us to stop the work at project site, particularly in the month of April and May, till the lockdown is lifted. Which what? At the project site, even if I have the raw material, even if I have the manpower, I will not be able to execute the projects because the client has told me not to execute the project. It's as simple as that. Whereas in Q1 FY22, that problem is not there. The supply chain is intact. And also the migration of labor was also relatively less. But in the current year, in the first quarter, we had sporadic cases of COVID-19 coming at some of the project sites. But we have taken remedial measures to see that the problem is contained well in time, and that has helped us very nicely. And as far as the order booking is concerned, despite COVID-19, last year we had bagged about 9% of fresh orders. That is a demonstrated government desire to kickstart the economy by calling for a lot of tendering for development of physical infrastructure. And we, being one of the frontline companies, we were able to take advantage of that. In fact, last year, we have exceeded the guidance as far as the order booking is concerned, because we got about 19,000 crores of orders. Now, the tempo is likely to continue in the current year also. Already in the first 4 months of the current year, we bagged about 4,000 crores of orders. But the issue of giving guidance for FY22 was discussed in our board. And because of the uncertainty and also the third wave of COVID expected in the month of August and also September, the board has felt that we cannot give any guidance as far as the top line and as far as the order book or order accretion for FY22 are concerned. So that is the situation as far as guidance is concerned. But we are sitting on a good order book of nearly 39,000 crores, and most of the orders are under execution. We have got strong execution teams for taking care of completing the projects. That will help us, and I am quite sure, though I cannot give a number because of the board direction, FY22 should be far better than FY21 in terms of top line and in terms of bottom line. As far as the macro environment is concerned for FY22, we are looking at this Jal Jeevan mission as a thrust area for us. You must be aware, the central government has made it a national project. Supply of potable drinking water to all the citizens in all the states and all the villages, and also the last mile connectivity. The Jal Jeevan is a central government sponsored project, and that is being likely to be implemented across the country. In fact, Telangana was the first state to start Mission Bhagiratha and complete the project. Now that is going to be replicated across the country with the help of the central government. We bagged, already you may be aware, some orders in the state of Uttar Pradesh, about 6,200 crores under Jal Jeevan mission. And now other states have started calling for tenders. Recently, Madhya Pradesh has floated the tenders. Likewise, Maharashtra is also planning. So we will participate there also. So as far as FY22 is concerned, because we have done the Mission Bhagiratha project in the state of Telangana earlier, and we have got a strong execution team in our water vertical, the water and environment division, we are confident that we will be able to bag similar orders in other states also as we go forward. So for the current year, we are looking at the affordable housing projects and also the Jal Jeevan mission to be drivers of growth, drivers of order book as far as NCC is concerned. Added to that, perhaps you will be aware, we have got a strong mandate and a strong leadership position in the verticals of buildings, water pipelines, and road projects. In fact, these three verticals put together constitute about 75% to 80% of our order book as well as the turnover of the company. We have a leadership position in all these verticals, particularly in buildings, 1,000 crores and above. We are able to bag substantial orders. We are doing about 4 medical campuses for the All India Institute of Medical Sciences in various locations. And also we are doing 2 airport projects. One is the Lucknow Airport and the Patna Airport for the Airport Authority of India. We are doing some defense projects. 2 packages we have got from the Indian Navy for the Seabird Karwar project in Karnataka. That is also going on well. Now the Central Vista project in New Delhi, the Parliament Annex and those buildings, about 19,000 crores worth of building projects are like to be called for tendering. We will definitely participate in those orders also and try our luck there. And we are quite active in the metro projects. We are doing 2 packages in Pune, 2 packages in Nagpur, 1 package in Bombay. Earlier we completed 1 package in Chennai, and 1 package we are doing right now in Bangalore city. So the metro is also a very good thrust area. Payment cycle is good, and we have got strong execution capabilities in the metro projects also. Likewise, in roads, we are doing the Nagpur-Mumbai Expressway, about 2,850 crore package given to us by MSRDC. I am glad to inform you that the project is progressing well despite COVID-19. We were able to complete almost 90% of the project, and the government has mandated various agencies to give a cushion of about 6 months for completion of the projects. And if that is granted, there is a good possibility we may get a bonus also in that project. So roads we are looking at positively. We are excited with expressways. Earlier we have done the Nagpur-Mumbai expressway successfully and got a bonus. Agra-Lucknow Expressway. Now we are doing the Nagpur-Mumbai Expressway. Here also we are targeting the bonus. And also we are looking at the hybrid entity projects. We started bidding for them. So current year also, these three verticals, that is buildings, roads, and water pipelines, will form the backbone of the company, and substantial order acquisition we are expecting in this segment also. As far as the payment cycle is concerned, things have improved. The central government agencies, many of them are AAA rated companies, and once the work is done and bill is certified, payments are coming in time. In fact, the finance ministry has also directed government agencies to see that the payments are released to contractors, provided the work is done and bill is certified, so that the wheels of the economy keep moving. That is also helping us in many ways. But we have some difficulties as far as the state government projects are concerned, mainly because there are some delays in payment of our bills by the state government agencies, mainly because of COVID too, and their focus has shifted to welfare measures and healthcare measures, and payments to contractors are in the back burner. But we are struggling and pushing them and seeing that payments are received. There are some delays, but payments are coming there also. As far as the liquidity is concerned, the company is well placed. We are able to comfortably navigate the difficult times. We have not defaulted with our lending consortium banks. All the payments are made on time, BLC payments and also interest payments, and also term loan installment payments to various equipment for financials. We have taken the COVID loan given by our consortium banks at a concessional rate as mandated by Reserve Bank of India, and that also helped us. And liquidity-wise, we are comfortably placed. And also, many of our projects, mobilization advance are being released by the clients. That is also helping us to see that our cash flow is well maintained. As far as the interest rates are concerned, we were able to successfully bring down the blended cost of borrowing to below 9%. And many banks have passed on the benefit of policy rate reduction by the Reserve Bank to companies like us, particularly because of our long-term relations with the banks, and also because of our rating and our track record of honoring all our commitments without any difficulty. So we don't see any difficulty on those lines. As far as bank guarantees are concerned, again, there is some good improvement. The Finance Ministry last year has given a relief to construction companies by permitting the reduction in the performance guarantee value on a pro rata basis linked to the progress of the project. If the project is completed 50%, the performance guarantee value can come down by 50%. That was a big relief to companies like us. And during the last 15 months, we were able to bring back about 1,000 crores of bank guarantees from various clients. So those guarantee limits are available to us for our future projects. Another relaxation given by the Finance Ministry because of COVID-19, the performance guarantee requirement has been brought down from 10% to about 3%. And also, they have dispensed with providing bid bonds at the time of bidding for the projects. All these measures are helping the company to see that enough bank guarantee limits are available for the new projects, for bidding and taking up the projects. Our bankers also have sanctioned additional financial assistance in the State Bank of India, Karnataka Bank, and some other banks in the consortium have sanctioned. Now we are comfortably placed as far as the bank guarantee limits are concerned, as far as the LC limits are concerned, as far as the fund-based requirement is concerned. So company is definitely on a good growth path, a lot of opportunity. We started bidding for the high-speed rail projects also. We have tied up with another construction company as our partner, and together we are bidding for bigger packages of 10,000 crores and above for the high-speed rail projects. And we are confident that some projects will definitely come to us. So these are the broad picture I wanted to give as far as the construction business is concerned and companies positioning in the construction industry is concerned. Now I request my colleague, Mr. Krishna Rao, to talk about the first quarter results.
Yeah, very good evening to you all. Thank you, sir. To begin with, the order book summary is like this. Orders on hand at the beginning of the quarter, 37,928 crores. New orders received during the quarter, 3,171 crores. Works executed during the quarter, 2013. And the closing order book as at the end of the quarter is 39,087 crores. The turnover part, the company achieved a turnover of 1,912 crores, including other income in the first quarter, as against 1,211.41 crores in the corresponding quarter of the previous year. As a result, the increase in turnover is 58% year-on-year basis. The company has reported EBITDA of 199.68 crores and a net profit of 51.68 crores as against 115.63 crores and 16.93 crores reported respectively in the corresponding previous year. The turnover numbers on a consolidated basis are: the turnover during the quarter is 2083.21 crores as against 1,328.71 crores, resulting the increase in turnover of 57% on a consolidated basis. The company has reported EBITDA of 211.25 crores and a net profit of 49.95 attributable to shareholders as against 124.82 crores and 15.68 crores respectively in the corresponding previous year. Now we will analyze the expenditure. Salaries and allowances during the quarter, first quarter of 2021, many new projects have started. Operations are going at full level. And the salaries and allowances compared to the corresponding quarter, 9 crores is increased. This is primarily on account of increase in headcount. And administrative cost is more by 15 crores. Because in the previous quarter, there were restrictions in the movement. Many states lockdown has imposed. Now it is not there. And people are moving around to the projects. And continuously the operations are on. Apart from, there is a provision of 6 crores in the year. And CSR, we have spent 2 crores. These are with regard to the administrative. And interest during the quarter, there is a 12 crores reduction compared to previous quarter. This is primarily the repayment of the loan, number one, and a reduction in the interest rate. That is what my colleague mentioned. With this, we are going to stand at EBITDA level for the first quarter, 10.6%. As against 9.8% of the corresponding previous quarter of the year. Now the EBITDA level at the consolidated level are 10.2 and 9.6 of the corresponding previous quarter of the year. Now we will take up the order book division wise. Building division at the beginning of the quarter, 21,157 crores. It represents 56%. And the closure is 22,183. It represents 57%. Roads beginning 1,954 crores. And at the end of the quarter, 1,532. Water and environment, 7,078 crores. At the closure of the quarter, 7,980, and electrical, irrigation, mining, and other divisions, it remains no change mostly. The closing order status at electrical is 2,215, irrigation 2,406, mining 2,528, and others all together 229, with this, the closing order book 39,087. Now the receivables, the debtors outstanding at the end of the quarter is 2,600 crores. And the debtors collection period is 125 days as against 134 days of the corresponding previous quarter. Now the capex for the year, we have the capital budget of 250 crores and for Q1, 38 crores. The debt position at the end of the quarter. We have for the standalone at the end of the quarter 1,936 crores. There is a reduction of 147 crores. There is an increase because of the utilization of the working capital loan. And on a standalone basis, the debt. On a consolidated basis, the debt closing stands at 2,135 crores, an increase of 73 crores compared to previous quarter. And the loan rate of interest, there is a reduction to the tune of 0.43%. And AP orders, including that the AP new orders, we have as at the end of the quarter 5,214 crores, and the receivables, so there is a receivables reduction in the receivable to the tune of 18 crores and retention money to the tune of 6 crores. So the receivables stands at the end of the quarter 233 crores, and the bees, there is a reduction in the bees as against 914 crores. We have 856 crores. We were able to collect more than 54 crores, and balance sheet investment, with regard to the investment, there is a reduction to the tune of 16 crores. We were able to go disinvest, and the trade receivables, there is a decrease to the tune of 47 crores. Retention money, there is an increase to the tune of 8 crores. Unbilled revenue increase 217 crores. And cash equivalents, there is a decrease to the tune of 123 crores. Margin money, there is an increase to the tune of 57 crores. Where we are participating into the more tenders. And with regard to the borrowing, there is a utilization of working capital. It is more by 208 crores. And other borrowings, so loans and the equipment term loans, there is a reduction to the tune of 62 crores. Mobilization advance, there is an increase to the tune of 114 crores. With this, I wish to conclude from my end. Now I will request my colleague to take forward.
Second. One or two points to add to what our colleague has told about the results. The subsidiary companies and the JCBs of NCC reported a turnover of 172 crores. And a profit of 2.2 crores in the first quarter of the current year. The subsidiaries in Oman and Dubai put together reported a top number of 2.9 crores and a loss of 3.14 crores. As you know, we are winding up our business in the Gulf region. This is the last time they are showing some top number. Other than that, only the residual works and closure of the business there is happening. The other one is NCC Urban. They reported a turnover of 10.74 crores, our real estate subsidiary in India, and a loss of 1.51 crores. NCC Infrastructure Holdings our holding company for BOT projects reported a turnover of 1.12 crores and a loss of 0.54 crores. OB infrastructure, 14.85 crores turnover and a profit of 4.39 crores. Pachwara coal mining, a turnover of 129.5 crores and a profit of 3.79 crores. So the total from all the subsidiaries and the associated companies put together, the turnover is 171.52 crores and the PAT is about 2.2 crores. So this is taken into the consolidated balance sheet of the company, of which we have already given the details. As far as the finance cost is concerned, my colleague has already mentioned that the finance cost has come down by about 12 crores compared to the first quarter of the previous year. Likewise, in the last year also, the finance cost has come down by about 60 crores for the year as a whole, FY21. So we are putting a lot of efforts to see that the costs are cut as much as possible. And the details of the finance cost, that is about 103.72 crores that we have incurred in the first quarter, comprise of interest on term loan 6.39 crores, interest on cash credit and WCDL 36.58 crores, interest on mobilization advance 28 crores, interest on others 1.72 crores, then BG commission 26.9 crores, LC commission 2.86 crores, and bank and other finance charges 1.21 crores. The total for the quarter is 103.72 crores. As compared to first quarter of last year, it is less by about 12 crores. And debt we have already covered. And now, loans and advances to our group companies. It has come down to about 295 crores. Investment in associates is about 998.54 crores. That comprises of our equity investments. And group exposure is about 1,284 crores. It is more or less at the, you see, at the end of first quarter last year is about 1,472 crores. It has come down by about 150 crores. That is mainly because of the repayment of debt by NCC Urban to the parent company and also conversion of debt into equity in the books of NCC Urban pertaining to parent company. Cash and bank balances 373 crores is there. Inventories, raw material is about 511.9 crores. And the property development cost is about 15 crores. Total inventory is about 527 crores. Trade receivables we have already covered. Depreciation is about 45, and a consolidated base 45.91 crores. A standalone depreciation is
44.
Yeah, 44 crores. 44.7 crores as compared to previous quarter, the first quarter of previous is 43.5 crores. Interest income is, other income is, details of other income, that is 13.31 crores. In that, other income of 19.29 crores. Out of that, interest income is 13.31 crores. Then miscellaneous income is 4.62 crores. Rental income is 0.3 crores. Profit on sale of fixed assets is 0.23 crores. So these are the details that we wanted to share with the investors. And now I request the participants to ask their questions. And I request you to restrict your questions to not more than 20 questions. And each participant should not ask more than 2% because of paucity of time. Now we can open the session for discussion.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, please press star and two. Participants are requested to please limit their question to two per participant and to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Shravan Shah from Dolat Capital Markets. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Sir, you have already said that we are not giving a revenue guidance and order inflow also. But in terms of the EBITDA margin, last time we have spoke about 11.5% kind of if the things are normalized. So how do we now look at for full year EBITDA margin absolutely? And secondly, in the standalone date, which has increased close to 150 odd crore versus March. So how do we look at for the full year date level?
Yeah, first EBITDA margin. The FY21, we reported EBITDA margin of 11.8% as compared to 12.5% in the previous financial year, that is 31st March 2020. As far as the current year is concerned, in the first quarter, we reported EBITDA of 10.55, which is slightly better than 9.8 reported in the first quarter of the previous year. But it is less than the total EBITDA margin of 11.88 reported for the year as a whole. That is understandable because of the pandemic and because of the took a beating because of the commodity prices have gone up quite high. We actually lost about 1% in our gross profit margin level. So the 10.55 for the first quarter current year is understandable. But for the year as a whole, we are targeting EBITDA of 11.75 to 12% as reported last year. We are confident we'll be able to bounce back as far as the EBITDA margins are concerned. And also the PAT levels also have improved nicely in the first quarter of this year as compared to first quarter of last year. And the PAT margin also improved. First quarter was about 1.4%, now it is about 2.7%. We are expecting further increase in the PAT margin, and we are confident for the year as a whole, a PAT margin of 3.5 to 4% can be achieved. Now, what is the other question, please?
Sir, I was asking in terms of the standalone date, which has increased to now 1,936 crores. So how do we look at, and at the same time in terms of the interest cost, which has actually reduced? So for the full year, for this quarter, it is already 103 odd crores. Can we look at around 400, 420, 10 crores, or it will be closer to the last year of 460 odd crores?
Yeah, last year the finance cost is about 457.78 crores. This year, first quarter is 103 crores. We are confident year as a whole, the finance cost should be between, say, 430 to 450 crores for the current financial year. And also, reduction of debt. You see, various elements are there in this. We are trying to do our best to see that the debt levels are reduced. Last year, we reported a debt equity of 0.3:1, which is one of the best in the industry. But in the first quarter, some increase is there in the debt. Mainly because of the utilization of the working capital limits from the banking system. That is in turn because of some delay in payments by various government agencies, particularly the state government agencies. In our electrical division, payments were delayed in the state of UP and Jharkhand, and that created some difficulty, but the debt levels have gone up. But we believe it is temporary in nature. And going forward, if you see the year-end debt, for example, in 2020, our debt reported at the end of the financial year 2020, 1,910 crores. Last year, that is FY21, it is 1,788.9 crores. That is a reduction in debt by about 130 or 140 crores compared to the previous year. Similar thing, we are targeting, 20, it has gone up to 2,050 crores because of the pandemic and all those things are there. But current year, we are confident we will be able to come back to that March 21 level of debt, let's say about 1,780 or so. In fact, there's a possibility it could be a further reduction in debt to a level of, let's say, 1,500 to 1,600 crores. we are trying to monetize some of our assets, and if that materializes in the current financial year, that will help us to bring down the debt level further.
Sorry to interrupt, may I request Mr. Shah to please rejoin the queue? We have participants waiting for the turn.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Mohit Kumar from DAM Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good evening, sir. And congratulations on good order accretion in the quarter and in the July especially. So my first question, at the end of June 21, the 25% out of 100% of order book work on the 25% has not started. Has there been any increase or decline in that number? And the work and the related question is the work on the UPJJM or the recognition of the UPJJM revenue. Will it start in the second half?
You see, as far as the 25% you are talking about, one thing is in UP, we bagged about 6,200 crores of Jal Jeevan Mission projects in December, but that work is yet to start. That is one thing that is delaying it. Other than that, whatever projects I received, say, in the month of February, March 21, FY21, those orders for us to mobilize and start work at project site and for the client to proceed, etc., handing over the project site and all, 3 to 4 months. So because of that also, the works would not have commenced. That is a normal practice, nothing to worry about that. But once the work starts, the execution can pick up faster and quicker. That is the point I want to make. What is the other one you ask?
No, sir. My question is answered, sir, mostly. So, secondly, sir, any update on rupees 2.3 billion dues stuck on the AP projects and on the real estate monetization of NCC Vizag Urban?
Yeah, as far as AP is concerned, we already told you the figures, particularly the receivables and all that. We got payments of about 400 crores from the government of AP agencies during the last 15 months. That is full year of last year and 3 months of current year. And also, the number of bank guarantees have come back. And we have proactively taken up the matter with the government agencies in AP. And we requested them to adjust the mobilization advance available to lying with us against the payment of bills. That also has helped us to bring down the outstanding by about 250 crores or so. Now the residual bills to be paid, there are some delays. We are also taking up the matter with the government agencies. In fact, we were recently in Vijayawada discussing the matter with the top people in all these organizations. They in turn got the government approval to borrow about 3,000 crores with the government guarantee. The government has given a GO. In fact, they gave us a copy of the GO and they are in the process of tying up the debt predominantly to see that the outstanding bills of contractors like us are paid and also the outstanding work is also completed. So we are expecting good progress in that direction in current financial year.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Parikshit Sandapal from HDFC Securities. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. My first question is on, you said that you are winding up the international operation, so this probably was the last quarter of revenue. So how much of cash inflows are we can expect from the winding up of these operations?
Durga, can you answer this question, please?
Yes, sir. So, I mean, and again, internal operations, there are two things. One is Oman entity, another one is Mauritius. So, the Oman operations, we are completing the pending order worth about 17 crore. So,
Mr. Durga Prasad, our associate director, Mr. R.S. Rajgar is here. He will be able to brief little. One moment, please.
Hello.
Yeah, hi, Raju sir. My question was.
Hi, sir.
Yes, so Parikshit here, sir. My question was, how much of inflows can happen to NCC by winding up the international operations? So whatever the pending receivable collections we made, so if you can give a ballpark number, how much we can expect proceeds from winding up the operations?
As far as the operations are concerned, in Oman, all the contracts we completed. In Qatar, one project is there, and it takes another 4 to 5 months to close. Only residual amount, about 20-25 crores, is there to complete. So as far as the operations are concerned, are over, only the final bills, and somewhere some claims are there. Those amounts have to be realized. So that again, the size of the amounts pending as on the date is about. The 290 crores are there. So this 290 crores, more than 50% of the amount will be get realized by December 22, and the balance, some claims are there that they're scheduling to realize in 22-23. So there are only two aspects. One is completion of the operations, that is over. Another one is realization of this one, and the fixed assets also, 90% of the assets, whatever there, they sold there. And the bank loans are concerned, all the loans are cleared except the bill discounting bills, which get cleared on receipt of the corresponding bills. So the international showmen also repatriating some of the amounts to parent company on month-on-month basis, since there is no further requirement to. So on relation of these amounts, the company planning to send the amounts about 100 crores in the year 21-22. So that is their plan of action.
Okay. The second question was on the irrigation project. So this tussle which is going on between the central government and the state government, and so has the work stopped altogether as per the central advice, or are the works are continuing? So if you can just update on the status of the irrigation project.
In Oman?
No, sir. Irrigation projects in AP and so in Telangana. So whether the projects continue or they have been stopped as per the central government advice?
In AP.
So for your irrigation project.
In AP. Only the projects which are related to the capital city projects, they're not running. We have stopped those things. Only we are looking for the settlement of the government, and government is also working on that one, basing on our persuasion. And we understand that some of the projects in the capital city, they revise those projects and they may ask to carry out to complete certain things, but the clarity has not yet come. So they may descope some projects to close, and some projects they may close as it is. So like that are there as far as the capital city projects are concerned. And to continue those projects, the department also pursuing for the budget, and they're trying for the loans. And the loan tie-up they want to first make, and then give the clearance to carry the works. As far as AP TIDCO projects are concerned, so whatever we have done on that one, major to the payment, they release, and some balance payments are all there. And as and when they're asking, partly we are doing on that one, AP TITCO projects. Other than those projects, but rest of the projects, wherever are there, they are going, but not at the higher level, but lower level, the projects are carrying, basing on their payments and basing on the budget allocation.
Just one more point on this. As far as the capital city is concerned, we are doing the secretariat building project, about 470 crores or so. That is going to be cancelled because the administrative capital is being shifted to Visakhapatnam. In that, we have done about 10 to 15% of the work, and that is likely to be cancelled. That is de-scoped already. The client has to settle our bills. The other one we are doing is the MLA quarters, because Amaravati is going to be the legislative capital of the state. Though that building work is going on,
In fact, government also told us to complete that project. Already 75-80% work has been completed, and that also will be completed soon.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Vibhor Singhal from PhillipCapital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good evening, sir. Thanks for taking my question. And congrats on a strong performance in this difficult time. So two questions from my side. As Shravan had asked before, basically, what is the timeline that we are looking for the Jal Jeevan Mission projects? As you mentioned that we have not yet started on those execution on those projects. So by when do we think that the execution will start and revenue will start flowing in into those projects? And secondly, you mentioned about the bullet train projects. Sir, as we understand, I think the earlier packages which were all to be awarded in Gujarat have all been taken up by L&T. And the remaining packages which are probably there are in the state of Maharashtra, where I think there is not good enough support from the state government in terms of land acquisition and other clearances. So if you could just tell us what is the status of those packages in Maharashtra and what is the clarity given to you by the department in terms of when these projects could come up for bidding.
There are some more packages likely to be called for tendering in Gujarat. And we will definitely participate there. As far as Maharashtra is concerned, there is no clarity unless the state government acquires the land and makes it available to the project company for execution. We have to wait and see. You are right. All the three previous project packages have gone to L&T, but we are definitely in the race as far as high-speed rail projects are concerned. What is the other question?
First question on the Jal Jeevan Mission project. When do you think the
We have to develop a detailed project report submitted to the government agency who is authorized to approve the project, usually the district collector or somebody. And once that is approved, they will give us the go-ahead and give us the mobilization advance with the bank guarantee, security and all. And the entire process they have given us outer limit of about 18 months. District-wise, we are taking it up. The project reports are getting ready. It got delayed somewhat by about 2-3 months, but very shortly we are expecting their approval for go-ahead in one or two districts. Once it is approved, we have to complete it within the period of 3 years. So the project delay is there, but it's likely to take off now.
So, sir, when can we expect revenue to start coming in? Let's say the first rupee of revenue to start coming in from this project.
Maybe in a month or so.
Oh, in a month or so.
Yeah.
Right. Sure, sir. Great. Thank you so much for taking my questions and wish you all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Prem Khurana from Anand Rathi. Please go ahead.
Thanks for taking my question, sir. So two questions. So one was, I think in your opening remarks you spoke about your interest in hybrid annuities. So, but when I looked at the commentary that you generally gave us, is essentially the idea is to kind of try and conserve cash, which is why I think you're planning to exit all your international ventures, and the idea is to kind of sell some real estate as well, and the NCC urban real estate, as which clearly comes to imply that you're looking at cash flows. I mean, given this backdrop, why is it that we're planning to kind of get into hybrid? Because hybrid, you would be required. I mean, I understand, I mean, the kind of investment that would go would not be comparable to the number that we used to have with the BOT toll, but it still would require to kind of infuse money. So if you could help us understand this thing.
Got your question. Let me answer that. Given a choice, we prefer cash contracts as far as the road segment is concerned. We have shown our propensity to bag expressways, etc. And also we have demonstrated our capability to execute them faster and quicker. That will continue. But because the hybrid annuity is also comparatively looking better compared to BOT projects, and a large number of hybrid annuity projects are coming, and we also would like to test the waters, have a foothold in the hybrid annuity project business. And we have got a strong balance sheet and have good linkage with the banking system in terms of tie-up of debt, etc. for the SPV. So we are looking at hybrid annuity also as a possible destination, but our focus will remain on cash contracts as far as the road projects are concerned, and maybe we will take up hardly one or two hybrid entity projects, and our balance sheet will support that without much difficulty.
Sure. And so what kind of IRR would you target, I mean, if you would try and get into this case?
That is difficult to say at this stage. Let the project come, then I can share with you, because there is O&M also involved in that. We are also looking for a partner to participate on the equity side right from the beginning. With an agreed IRR and things like that. So I cannot discuss about that at this point in time.
Sure. And last quarter, you'd given the breakup, receivables breakup for AP in terms of, I mean, the running orders and stuck orders. Possible to share that number? And also, if you could share cash and bank balance as of 30th June on standalone basis.
Yeah, AP projects, outstanding receivables, my colleague Durga Prasad will explain to you. Please go ahead.
As far as receivables are concerned, for running projects, as of 174.54 crore, capital city projects 58.87 crore, so total receivable, net receivable is 233.41 crore. So as far as unbilled revenue, work in progress is concerned, for running projects it is 215.10, capital city stuck projects 122.39. So total work in progress or unbilled revenue, it is 337.49 crore. So receivables plus WAP put together is 570.90 crores. So in addition, retention money receivable is 278 crore.
Thank you.
So this is the status. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Zakir Nasir from Nasir Investments. Please go ahead.
Hello.
Yes, please go ahead.
Yeah, sir. Congrats on a reasonable set of numbers considering the bad scene, sir. You have not given any guidance, but could we assume that the first quarter is not a full potential quarter, and in regards to work and clients asking you to start work, July, have they reverted their earlier stance and the work has started? Thank you, sir.
Yeah, work has started, and definitely we have an advantage, because we are starting the year with a good order book of nearly 39,000 crores, and we have got strong execution capabilities. Definitely, FY22 should be far better than FY21 as far as top line is concerned, as far as bottom line is concerned. But I cannot give a number because the board has decided to not to give any guidance. My gut feeling is, at a personal level, easily 20 to 25% top line growth in FY22 can be achieved as compared to FY21.
Fantastic, sir. That would take you across 10,000 crores. Thank you, sir, and best wishes for the year. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ankita Shah from Milara Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Basically, my question was on the interest expenses guided for 450 crore of number for this year also, which is almost like flattish as compared to last year. This is despite you've been highlighting the reduction in the interest expense and the bank guarantee and bank commission charges. Also, you are guiding for a lower leverage and reduction in debt. So why not reduction in interest expense?
Yeah, I will explain. You see, we call it the finance cost. It comprises of various elements. The interest is one portion of that. The other one is the bank guarantee commission, the LC commission, even interest on mobilization advance, which is the advance that the client is giving to us. Now, you will appreciate we have mobilization advance outstanding of about 1,400 crores. On that also, we have to pay interest to the client. So all these are taken into account. So a sensible way of looking at it is, what is the proportion of the finance cost to the turnover of the company. We normally see that it is maintained around 5% or so. So in the current year also, we are targeting the same number despite reduction in interest costs. And one more thing that I would bring to your notice is the commission on bank guarantees has not come down. On the contrary, it is increasing because the Reserve Bank has mandated on bank guarantees also, full capital provision should be made by the banks. Earlier it was 50%, now it, they made it 100%. So based on this, they are working out the return on capital employed on bank guarantees, and so the commission rates have gone up across the board for all the construction companies, including our company, and so that may not be likely to come down. So I believe 450 crore for FY22 should be reasonable. That this finance cost includes various other elements also, other than the interest cost. The interest cost has come down nicely, and we are thankful to the banks for extending that interest cost reduction to our company based on our rating, based on our conduct of accounts, and also our long association with the banks, etc. But the finance cost cannot disappear from the balance sheet. It has got to be there. And if I do a turnover of 9,000 crores, and if I pay, say, about 5% on that, 450 crores or so, I should be ready to accept that.
Okay. And secondly, on your debt collection period of 125 days, this continues to remain elevated as compared to 127 days as on March year end. That's almost 2,500 crore of total receivables, and out of that, I see around 200 crores would be from AP. Then, which are the other key receivables which are pending, and do we see any kind of reduction in the near term?
Yeah, you see, madam, you have to realize that this is a difficult year, the pandemic year. The entire industry is suffering, the economy is suffering, economy is shrunk. So all these issues are there. And also, I briefly made a reference in my opening remarks that the payments from the state governments are coming a bit slow, mainly because their focus is on containing the pandemic, and also they are focusing more on healthcare measures and welfare measures. The AP, definitely the issue is there. We already discussed. I told you that the government is planning to borrow money and pay all our bills, etc. Other than that, we have delay in the payments in the state of Uttar Pradesh and Jharkhand in our electrical division. Those payments have to come from REC, at least 90% of the payment from the central government agency. There is some delay, but I think the payments are likely to be received very shortly. So we have to see the macro environment, how it is panning out, and the 125 days debt collection period is definitely on the high side. But if the economy improves and things will fall in place, I think the debt collection period can come down to below 100 days.
Sure. Could you please help me with that UP and Jharkhand electrical projects receivable number?
Durgapsa, do you have those numbers?
No. I'll share it with Ankita sir. Tomorrow I'll share.
No problem.
We'll
no
share.
Problem. Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Deepak Purda from Sapphire Capital. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much, sir. So I have two questions. Now, the first one is on the debt side. You did speak about debt reduction. Now, my question pertains to FY23. Now, since you are expecting a debt reduction by year end, YOY FY23 or interest cost should decline as compared to what outlook you have given for FY22?
We have to work out a business plan for FY23. Other than that, I cannot give offhand any number. But definitely the direction, the management is very keen that the debt levels in the company should come down gradually. That is happening. We are already looking at some asset monetization. If those monies are received, that will also help us to bring down the debt levels. If the client payments improve, because the economy has improved, again, our requirement to draw debt will come down drastically. All these things are there. And our aim is to see that FY22, the debt level should come down to by another 200 crores, which means about 1,500 to 1,600 crores as compared to March FY21.
Okay. So debt level you mentioned about 1,500 to maybe 1,650 crores this year, right? So is there any kind of target we have for FY23 as well?
That again, we have to work out the business plan for that year.
Okay.
That is too early to predict anything.
Okay.
What will be the turnover, what will be the order accretion, how much of mobilization advance I can get, and my execution cycle. Based on that, how much debt I will draw. And based on that, how much bank guarantees I take.
Mm-hmm.
All those things are involved in that.
Mm-hmm. Understood. Fair enough. Okay, sure. That's it from my side. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Parvez Akhtar Kazi from Edelweiss Securities. Please go ahead.
Hi, good afternoon, sir. Thanks for taking my question. Two questions from my side. First, if you could tell us about the status of some of the asset monetization plans that we have, like for NCC, Urban Vizag. And second, also, if you could tell us about the status of the arbitrations for Sembcorp and Tata. Thank you.
Yeah, as far as the NCC Urban Vizag is concerned, the good news is we got the cabinet approval from the state of Andhra Pradesh, and we are on track to execute the mandate given to us, that is converting the property into a freehold property. We have identified a buyer who is likely to bring that money. The government has decided that a revenue share to be paid for conversion of this property into a freehold property, some 97 crores. And then it has to be registered in favor of the project company. That will cost another 80 crores. All that money is coming from the incoming investors, so we need not pay anything. After that process is completed and the land is registered in favor of the project owner, the incoming investor will repay the debt lying in the books of the project company given by NCC, that is about 192 crores or so. So that money is likely to come to us before the end of the calendar year, that is before 31st December 2021. Later on, the equity part also will be transferred in three tranches by the incoming investor in our favor. On a net basis, after doing all these things, we are likely to get about 375 crores by selling this property to the incoming investor. Out of this 375 crores, about 192 plus either Krishnada, what is the other amount?
50
is the 50 investment. No, out of that, how much will come in the current year?
180 current year.
314 crores, sir.
Ah, yeah. 314 will come in FY21 and balance will come in the next year.
Sure, sir. And, sir, about the arbitration?
About arbitration, Sembcorp, the arguments are going on. It got delayed because of COVID-19. And there are well-known Supreme Court judges on either side as members of the arbitration panel. They were able to convince the High Court and get extension of time. And the arguments are likely to be completed by December 2021. And the arbitration award is expected by March, April 2022.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ashish Shah from Centrum Broking Limited. Please go ahead.
Yeah. So just one question from my side. Out of the total order book of around 38,000-39,000 crores, how much would be classified as non-moving? Are there any orders which are stuck or non-moving which are part of the order book?
Krishna Rao, can you answer this question, please?
No, there are no such non-moving orders in the order book. All are executable and every order being in progress for execution.
Sure. Just to clarify your answer, sir, so basically, out of the total order book, you said there are no stuck or non-moving projects as such, but can you quantify the proportion of orders which are yet to begin execution, although they are not non-moving, but they are yet to begin execution. If any, we have any number on that front.
The yet to begin is only UP Jal Jeevan, that is what that the my colleague has explained in detail.
Okay, okay,
which is going to take place in next month, sir.
Sure, and nothing beyond that, right? I mean, no major other orders. Okay.
Yes, yes.
Sure. Yeah, we can go on, Rutuja. We can go on with the next question. Sir, shall we take another two or three questions?
Already for the past 1 hour we are talking, Ashish. Maybe
okay.
One more question we'll take. The last question. Sure. Okay, two questions we'll take. Fine. Go ahead.
Right. Okay, Rutuja, last two questions.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Saket Kapoor from Kapoor Company. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good evening, sir, and thank you, sir, for this opportunity. So firstly, a very small comment from my side, sir. The opening remarks from the management articulated the things in a much better way, giving us a very good picture of what the current situation is and what the outlook going forward. You covered many aspects of the call in your briefing, sir. So kudos to the team for covering it up very well, sir. And second point which I would like to just understand is that, sir, this interest part of 2000 crore going down to 1600-1700, what has led this to this built up of debt, sir, over a period of time, sir? What has attributed to this debt, if you could dwell something on it? How much is the legacy and how much is the asset that is going to build up
I will give you the bifurcation. The bulk of the loan is as by way of cash credit and WCDL by the banking system, consortium banks. The outstanding at the end of the quarter is 1,636 crores. You will appreciate we have a limit of 2,088 crores from the banking system available to us with enough drawing power, etc. But we have not drawn that fully. We have utilized only 1,636 crores. Other than this, we have got a COVID loan of 83 crores. Originally, they gave up to 152 crores. Now the repayment also started. This is a loan given at a very concessional rate, at the MCLR rate, without any cap, as directed by Reserve Bank of India. This loan was helpful to us last year in seeing that all payments are done on time without any difficulty. But we have not taken the moratorium granted by Reserve Bank in terms of payment of interest and in terms of payment of quarterly installments, etc., on the term loans. The third component of the loan is a machinery loan of about 215.9 crores. The total is 1,935.8, and that is a debt equity of about 0.3:1. And further reduction is possible as we go forward. And by the end of the financial year, that is March 22, we are targeting the debt level to come down to about 1,550 to 1,600 crores.
Right, sir. So on this PAT margin part, sir, if you could just reiterate, sir, what is the PAT margin guidance of trajectory that we are looking for versus the one for the last year?
Yeah, last year we reported a PAT margin of 3.5%, that is FY21. And current year also we are looking at a PAT margin of 3.5% to 4%. But first quarter it is less, it is only about 2.7%, but that is understandable. The turnovers were also less and input cost increases were also substantial. Yes. So shall we take the last question, please?
Thank you so much. This will be the last question, which is from the line of Parikshit Kandapal from HDFC Securities. Please go ahead.
Just wanted one clarification on the irrigation project, whether all our irrigation projects are under execution, because there was some guidance from the Jal Shakti Ministry to stop the project because of the AP and the Telangana government dispute regarding sharing of the water resources.
Krishna Rao, can you tell this?
Yeah, there are no such pending projects. The what we call here in Telangana, Mission Bhagirathi, The projects have already been completed. There are no such projects pending to be executed. This dispute between these two states are not going to be affected the operations of NCC.
No, so we have 2400 crores of irrigation projects in the order book, right? So all those are currently... No, no, order book. In the order book, we have about 2400 crores of irrigation projects.
They are all Amrit projects and they are funded by the AIB and the central governments. Absolutely, there should not be any problem.
Okay. So just lastly on just the execution part. So you... So this quarter, I mean, are we on track to see about 2,500 crores of turnover this quarter?
No, that is too early to say. We don't have the numbers, so we have to wait and see. And also the monsoon is there. It will take it a little while. And also the third phase of pandemic also is likely to strike. Maybe in the month of August itself, they're telling. So anyway, only 1 month is over and we don't have any numbers for that so far. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, this was the last question for today. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Ashish Shah for closing comments.
Yeah, on behalf of Central Broking, I'd like to thank all the participants. Thank you to the management of NCC for giving us the opportunity to hold this call and giving us the time. Thank you, sir. Any closing comments?
Thank you, Ashish. I thank Central Broking for hosting this conference call, and also I thank all the participants on my behalf as well as my on behalf of my colleagues here. And thank you very much. If you are unable to answer any of your questions, you can send us an email or talk to us on phone. Either myself or my colleague, Mr. Durga Prasad, will be able to take up your questions. Thank you all.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Mr. Ashish Shah.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Ashish. Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you. On behalf of Centrum Broking Limited, that concludes the conference call. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.